In this video, we're solving a conical pendulum. So in the conical pendulum, we have a simple pendulum with a string and a pendulum bob. And that pendulum bob is going to trace out a horizontal circular path. And as that pendulum bob revolves around, the string traces out the surface of a cone, which is why this is called a conical pendulum. Now in the problem, we're given the angle between the vertical and the angle of the string, and that's 25 degrees. And we're given the length of the string as 75 centimeters, and we're given the mass of the pendulum bob. And what we're trying to find here is the period of rotation. Now it actually turns out, if we keep everything symbolic for long enough, that the mass is going to cancel out of the equations here, so that 100 grams isn't even necessary to the problem. So the first point I want to make is that the radius of curvature of the circular path of this guy is not 75 centimeters. That radius of curvature is actually 75 times the sine of 25 degrees. So we're just going to leave that as a little r for now. So to start analyzing the problem, we want to get a complete force diagram into the picture, and we'll start with the force of gravity. Again, keeping things symbolic for the moment, we're just going to call that mg. The other force experienced by this pendulum bob is the tension in that string. And because we plan to use a capital T for the period of rotation, I'm just going to call that F. And there are no other forces acting on this pendulum bob. Remember, as you're setting up your force diagram, we want to restrict that to just real pushes and pulls. And we have gravity pulling down and then the string pulling at an angle. It's a common mistake to put in an extra force called the centripetal force. But in fact, the centripetal force has to be the result of some real push or pull happening in the problem. In this case, it's actually the inward component of that force F. So there's our force diagram, and then we're going to decompose that F into X and Y components. And just qualitatively, before we do any other analysis, I want to point out that Fy there is responsible for balancing the downward force of gravity. This pendulum bob is not going to move up or down, so those vertical forces must be balanced. And Fx, well, that's the centripetal force. In order for a mass to move on a circular path, there must be an inward pointing acceleration and therefore an inward pointing force. And we just found the source of that inward pointing force. It's just the X component of the tension. So now we proceed to do our Newton's second law of force analysis in the X and Y directions. I'm going to start with the Y direction because it's just simpler. In the y direction, I could say F net equals ma, but the acceleration in the y direction is zero. Alternatively, I can just say the forces balance. So I'm just going to say the upward force must be equal to the downward force. So Fy is equal to mg. And we'll go ahead and add some detail here. I marked these congruent angles in the diagram. Again, the angle between the vertical and the string was 25 degrees. And this angle is also 25 degrees. That means in this case, the y component of the force is given by F cosine of 25 because that's the adjacent side. So we'll just leave it like that for now. Now in the x direction, again, what I'm doing is applying Newton's second law. I know I have an acceleration pointing to the left because that's where the center of curvature is. So we're going to call that the positive direction. And I only have one force in that direction and it's Fx. So that's equal to the mass times the magnitude of the centripetal acceleration. So again, we'll throw in some extra detail here. That inward pointing component is given by F sine 25. And that's equal to the mass times the magnitude of the centripetal acceleration. So it's useful to remember the formula for centripetal acceleration expressed in terms of period. And that's a 4 pi squared r over t squared, where t is the period. Now, if you haven't used that formula before, here's where it comes from. Typically, students will remember that the centripetal acceleration is v squared over r. But if I think about one rotation of an object in circular motion, it covers one circumference, that's 2 pi r, every time one period goes by. So if I take distance divided by time there, I get the speed. So I replace v with 2 pi r over t, and I still have to square that thing. That gives me a 4 pi squared r squared over t squared. So we'll move the t squared to the denominator. One of the r's cancels, and we get that formula I just quoted above. So if you're running into a lot of uniform circular motion problems where period is given or where you're trying to find the period, it's way more convenient to start with that formula in your problem. Okay, so what we've built here is a system of equations, and the two unknowns there are F, that's the tension in the string, and then T, that's the period. So we'll go ahead and copy these down and just make a couple little changes. There's our first equation, F cosine 25 is mg. And then in the second equation, I'm going to rearrange things a little bit. So I'm going to write it as 4 pi squared m. And I'm going to replace r with its expression in terms of l. So remember that radius of curvature was smaller than the length of the string. And in fact, is given by l sine 25. And that whole thing is divided by t squared. Now what I notice here is the sine 25s cancel out. And there's a clever way to eliminate f from this system of equations. I can just take the top equation and divide by the bottom equation. On the left-hand side, I get f cosine 25 divided by f. Well, that's just cosine 25. On the right-hand side, I get mg divided by all this stuff. In other words, multiplied by the reciprocal of all this stuff in the second equation. So note first that the m's are going to cancel when I do the division. And then I'm thinking g times the reciprocal of 4 pi squared l over t squared. So that gives me gt squared over 4 pi squared l. Again, the goal here is to solve for t. So we're going to multiply both sides by 4 pi squared l and divide by g and then square root the result. So we end up with t equals the square root of 4 pi squared l cosine 25 divided by g. And note there that you could pull out the 4 pi squared from the interior of the square root, and that would become a 2 pi outside the square root. But we may as well just plug in our numbers now, and we get 4 pi squared times L, that's 0.75, just switching to SI units there, times cosine 25 degrees, all divided by G, and we'll just use the approximation 9.8. And when I run the numbers on this to 3 significant digits, I get a period of 1.65 seconds. So I want to make a note about physical intuition before we wrap things up here. If you imagine spinning a conical pendulum around, then I hope it seems intuitively clear that the faster you go, the bigger that angle gets with respect to the vertical. So it makes a lot of sense that knowing the angle uniquely determines a particular period of rotation. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. Or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.